Hello and welcome to this demonstration of NPView Professional on the desktop. My name is Joseph Baxter, Solutions Engineer with Network Perception. From this initial screen, you can see that I've created three workspaces. They're called Control System, EMS, and Demo. Workspaces are one of the concepts we use to organize your data and devices. I'm going to enter into the EMS workspace. I arrive at the home view. You can see the home view from the breadcrumbs here at the top. Sometimes called the bird's eye view, the home view distills everything down into the basic routing devices. This workspace has 8 configuration files imported, 6 firewalls, Palo Alto, and 2 Cisco routers. Now there's quite a bit of information that's hidden from this home view, so let's change to a more detailed view. The detail view that I've created earlier contains more of the information about this network. It includes hosts, other devices, perhaps VPN tunnels, the clouds, the subnets, things like that. Now that's a little bit messy, so let's unpin this from the workspace and let it kind of find its own path here. The Spring Force will help us uncross as many lines as possible and maybe make this network as symmetrical as possible. Some networks simply aren't symmetrical, but that's fine. From this detailed view, several networks appear. I can see 2 corporate networks appear on the top. That simulates perhaps 2 control centers, a backup and a primary. I can see 2 ESP firewalls, electronic security perimeter firewalls, that are protecting the control systems down here in the primary and the backup control center. Both control systems are linked with a VPN tunnel, as are the corporate networks. By selecting one of these devices, I can look at more details about how this network is routed and what communication paths are available from an end-to-end perspective. This device here simulates a jump host or an intermediate system intended as a protocol break between the control network and the corporate networks. Inbound, I can highlight this path between the 2 corporate networks and this jump host. You can see that the jump host is marked as destination, while as all these corporate networks are listed as the source. Here are the paths listed, and that's over port 3389, a remote desktop. Now that seems like that would be appropriate, since I would make an RDP connection into this jump host and then re-authenticate and come back out. Let's take a look at the outbound connectivity. Outbound connectivity, I see 3389 again, so jump host into this control network over remote desktop. That makes sense. Number 11, 100 to 105, 108 and 109, those are probably Windows hosts down here. I'd have to check my inventory to be sure, but that gives me a very quick viewpoint on what can come into this control network. But furthermore, I see also some port 22. This would be for Linux host. Perhaps there's some Linux devices down here. 254, that's probably a router. Number 2, maybe another firewall. But I've got some Linux devices or something that answers to SSH. And then lastly, I have 443, which would be HTTPS. Just 2 of these devices, 50 and 51, maybe GPS clocks, maybe like a Digi port server, something like that, that would answer to HTTPS or our web interface. Let's take a look at this host. If this device were in some way infected with self-propagating malware or ransomware, we might want to see how far that ransomware could get across my network based upon the connectivity in these firewalls. So selecting this device, I can go to Outbound Connectivity, go to my Stepping Stone, and run a Stepping Stone analysis. This lights up the map with different colors, red, orange, and yellow. So you can see that from this device as a source, there is one device up here that is directly connected in some way. There is a path through this firewall to this device. If that device were vulnerable to this ransomware or malware, that malware could take root and then pivot and infect across these other routers and firewalls every device that is highlighted in orange. From there, that second stepping stone, it could then pivot again and infect all of these devices that are highlighted in yellow. That would be a third stepping stone. From this penetration perspective, you can see that malware, ransomware, that type of software in your network can have quite a wide reach. Selecting a single firewall will reveal the risks and warnings raised by the NPView analytics engine. This firewall gets a risk assessment grading of the letter B, not an A, but not an F. There have been 4 risks that we have raised. Most of these have something to do with a rule that allows an any. These are medium risks because they are fairly well controlled on a particular group, an object, and a particular protocol. From this info pane, I also see the connectivity matrix, which shows the individual interfaces within the firewall and how they connect one with another. You'll see that Ethernet 1/4 can communicate to Ethernet 1/1 on port 9100. That's very interesting. Let's light that up. To start with, I'm going to create a new zone. I can create a zone out of any group of devices by simply selecting them, naming the zone, and flagging it for a criticality. I'm going to call this zone ESP and create it as a high criticality zone. This zone allows me to move around these large groups of assets, but also be able to run connectivity analysis from that zone. For instance, this zone allows port 9100 outbound through this firewall and into this corporate network. Now that's understandable because most administrators do not want to patch or do change management on printers. Let's focus in on one of these firewalls. This device is a Palo Alto firewall. We've given it a B as a risk assessment grade. That's because it has 4 medium criticality risks that we've raised from our analytics engine. They're medium because the rule allows communication from any. But they're not high because it is restricted to a particular group on a particular service. Our connectivity matrix gives a visual on how each interface interacts with all the rest of the interfaces on that device. You can see here that Ethernet 4 can communicate to Ethernet 1 on port 9100. That's that print spool we just saw. As our analytics engine raises risks and warnings, the user of NPView can deal with those using the risks and warnings interface. You can see here that these risks and warnings have been created as new. From here, we can handle those, marking them confirmed, marking them resolved, marking them a false positive, or perhaps even flagging them as a will not fix. This confirmed risk has been commented with an IT ticket number. The configuration file used to create this topology is available here. This device has only 1 configuration file available. However, this router has been updated recently. There are 2 configuration files available. A comparison can be seen here, revealing that an interface has been added. This marks the connectivity matrix to review. All changes to the workspaces, configuration file updates, and comments added are tracked in the change management interface. One of the most powerful features of NPView Professional allows you to validate your firewall access rules. Through this interface, you can review each and every rule and flag it as either OK, a rule that needs to be reviewed, or a rule that needs to be revised. These rules can be exported to Excel, brought back in after bulk editing, and even compared over time to see which rules have been added, removed, and changed. Finally, NPView Professional offers powerful reporting features. These reports take the form of a simple workspace report, an industry best practices report, or a detailed report on a specific compliance framework. Thank you for your time and your interest in NPView Professional.